Before I read the scripture lesson, let me set the scene for this story. As I mentioned in the announcements, if you really want to get the full picture of the story of Jacob, you need to start with verse 25 and just continue reading through verse 50, which is the end of the book of Genesis. But anyway, here's the background. Jacob, a ne'er-do-well, a scamp, and a cheat, has cheated his brother Esau out of his birthright and blessing. Esau is mad and threatens to kill Jacob. Jacob has, runs, flees from Esau, from his father's house, and is told to head to his uncle Laban's place. This is his mother Rebekah's brother. There, Isaac, Jacob's father, said, "You will find some marriageable women." On his way there, he has that dream where God enters his life. And then, when he arrives there, Jacob is at a well, which soon becomes known as Jacob's Well. Figured that. A woman catches his eye. It is the lovely Rachel. And Jacob immediately falls in love with Rachel. And Rachel, he learns, is the daughter of Laban, his uncle. And he goes to Laban to propose marriage to Rachel. And that's where we enter the story. Then Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel. So he said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It's better that I give her to you than I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife so that I may go into her, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. Laban gave his maid Zilpah to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah. And Jacob said to Laban, "What is this that you have done to me? Did I not serve you for Rachel? Why have you deceived me?" Laban said, "This is not done in our country, giving the younger before the firstborn. Complete this week, the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me for 7 more years. Jacob did so, completed his week, and then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This series, the Jacob Chronicles, are 6 scenes in the life of a man whom God chose, Jacob. They're stories of his journey. It's not merely a journey over land, it is a spiritual journey, a journey of encounter, a journey of change, a journey that leads to maturation. Ultimately, it is the story of God working in the life of an individual, molding, shaping, changing a human soul through dreams, through personal encounters, and through trying circumstances. Today's chronicle is a love story. But the themes of change, spiritual growth, and maturity are still present. And so in this message today, I'm going to retell the love story within its ancient context. Then I'd like to comment on some interesting dynamics that I see at work in this story. And then glean from the story particular lessons for for our contemporary age. The story, as I mentioned, begins with Jacob on the run. He was running from his brother Esau, who had threatened to kill him. Jacob cheated Esau and stole his birthright and the blessing that was due him. Jacob is not, how should I say it, 100% honest. He was also running to the land of his mother's ancestors. Rebekah, his mother, who was, kind of a favorite, saw him as a favorite, was always looking out for him. Jacob was truly a mama's boy. Now, being the favorite is not easy. Favorite sons often had a great deal of difficulty sustaining relationships. More often than not, mom does not think that any woman is good enough for her son. And that's both a powerful and also coercive influence. Rebekah wanted to make sure that her son Jacob married the right person. And her biggest fear was that he would marry one of the local Hittite women. And so she whined to Isaac. She said, "If Jacob marries one of these Hittite women, what good will my life be to me?" Isaac concurred. And the blessing that he bestowed upon Jacob mistakenly included an admonition to travel to his uncle's house. He told Jacob that his uncle Laban had two daughters that would be worthy of marriage. You'll recall that on that journey, Jacob experienced two of the three events that break down egocentricity, that break down selfishness, and contribute to spiritual growth and maturation. The first occurred in the struggle in the wilderness, when he suffered there at the elements. The second was his encounter in that dream, an encounter with a higher being, with a greater purpose than himself. Now he was about to experience the third, love and intimacy with another person. He was living in the land of his uncle Laban. Well, fetching water at the well, he suddenly beheld Rachel. She was keeping her father's sheep, and it was love at first sight. He fell in love with her. And we might assume from the story that she, too, fell in love with him. And if there was music playing in the background, and I always see these stories from, Genesis as kind of movies. If there was music playing in the background of the scene, it would be light, playful music. Music that literally dances in one's hearing. And it's under the spell of his love for Rachel that he enters into a deal with Laban. He agrees to work for Laban for 7 years. And after that period, Laban would give him Rachel as a bride. Now, this is not the first time in this series of stories that we have witnessed Jacob striking a bargain. We saw him bargain with Esau and then with his father. And both times, Jacob dealt from a position of strength. And it was usually reinforced by his cunning and his deceitfulness. But this time was different. He was bargaining with Laban, father of Rachel, while under the spell of love. He met his match at Laban. He truly did. And we should be shocked, literally shocked, at the deal that he cut with his future father-in-law, Laban. He agreed to work for 7 years. 7 years for the privilege of marrying Rachel. Does this sound like the Jacob that made the deal with Esau? Mm-mm. But this was not slavery either. Jacob entered the deal voluntarily. One wonders, why didn't he just deal Rachel and run away and elope with her? After all, he was used to running away. He ran away from everything. Why not do that here? This was completely out of character, was it not? And yet, under the spell of love, he agreed to serve Laban for 7 years. Ah, the power of romantic love. We read that those 7 years seemed like only a few days. The power of romantic love. But Laban tricked him again. On the day of after his wedding night, Jacob awakes from his wedding bed and realized it wasn't Rachel, it was Leah, the older sister. The chickens had literally come home to roost. The description of Leah is not as bad as some have thought it to be. But she was not the one whom Jacob loved. And so in anger, he went to Laban and agreed to work for 7 more years. 7 days later, Rachel was given to him in marriage. And so in the space of 1 week, Jacob has 2 wives, and our love story ends somewhat happily with an agreement of 7 more years of servitude. But there were some interesting dynamics that occurred in the story, and we should pay attention to them. The dynamics in particular that I want to look at are Jacob's transformation and growth. Last week, you will recall, I quoted the late John Sanford, an Episcopalian priest and psychologist. He wrote that there are 3 things which change a human being. The first is suffering, struggling with the issues that are so much a part of life. The second is an encounter with a higher power. When we've seen both of those occur, the third is coming to care for someone other than oneself. In Rachel, Jacob cared for someone other than Jacob. And thus, the trinity of transformation was fulfilled in his journey. Under the spell of love, he made a most surprising bargain. Jacob, to this point, did not distinguish himself as someone who was willing to work hard. He was lazy. He was shiftless. And when things got rough, he ran. But under the spell of love, in its grip, he agrees to work for 7 years. Now, one of the markers of maturity is that ability to delay gratification. Here we discover in Jacob's life, there is no desire for immediate gratification. Once again, compare that to Esau coming in from the field, wanting food right away. Give me the food, I'll give you my birthright. What is it to me? Jacob here is able to delay that gratification. Now let me digress for just a second to talk about romantic love. It's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. But it has a way of altering our reasoning ability. Now stay with me. It's a passive state of being. One does not decide to fall in love. One just falls in love the way you would fall into a hole. We say that a person is in love. It takes no effort to fall in love. It just happens. It's body chemistry. It's one of the miracles of creation. It really is. Yet the romantic love has this way of distorting reality. And often we see the other person as perfection. Romantic love puts that person and makes them the object of, makes them the object, puts them on a pedestal. Everything seems right about that person. And the relationship itself feels perfect. That's the power of romantic love. And under the spell of romantic love, we make all kinds of deals. We decide to get married. Underneath all the poetry, all the music that's part of romance, is the power of projection. Often the object of romantic love is merely an extension of oneself. And in a culture like ours, which holds romantic love as the ideal, such a view creates difficulty for because romance ultimately wanes. Now this crisis, however, can be creative, because the couple is then challenged to move from being in love, which is passive, to actively loving one another. And to actively love someone requires effort. Now there's no doubt that Jacob was in love. He agreed to do something that he wouldn't do otherwise. His reality was distorted, and consequently he agreed to Laban's deal. But all of this was tempered by 7 years of labor. And one of the ways to tell if a man loves a woman and vice versa is not, and is not merely under the spell of romance, is his or her willingness to work for the other. The ancient custom of willingly giving labor for a period of time to earn the right to marry was psychologically healthy. It also broke down the egotism and the selfishness that we often have, and it prepares an individual for a relationship with another. For Jacob, it meant that there were individuals who were more important than he was. This acknowledgement is the foundation of spiritual and psychological maturity. In other words, the voice of this coming generation, it's not all about me. Jacob worked for 7 years, and then 7 more. The love story has many lessons to offer. I'll suggest 3. First, in this story of Jacob and Rachel, romance is tempered by the willingness to work. You see, good relationships and marriage are not merely about romance. Their foundation is an active love, a love that's willing to work for the other, for the beloved. I believe that the 7 years of labor is more than symbolic in this story. You see, romantic love, which is often characterized by urgency, is tempered by this 7-year bargain. Now, one would think that sometime during those 7 years, it might occur to Jacob to say, what did I do? I got to get out of this and do a runner again. But he didn't. This was part of his transformation. He was able to make a commitment. So he worked for 7 years to be united with the one he loved. The social customs of the ancient world handle a crisis for which couples today are often unprepared. You know, often after a period of time, 7 years, romance begins to fade. You know, the drug of love wears off like Novocaine on a tooth. And this often produces a crisis. It's a crisis, though, I believe, with a remarkable opportunity. When one is no longer under the spell of romantic love, one begins to actively love the other. And when that occurs, one begins to grow and mature psychologically and spiritually. It requires an effort. It is not passive. And it's often then that we recognize the other as a real human being. And that means that there's more people in this world than just me. And it's then that we learn both to apologize and forgive and to do those things with integrity. And that, too, is part of a mature relationship. This is the foundation of active loving. Grace. The grace we know in Jesus Christ. The grace of God. The second lesson is this. The power of love and the work of actively loving add a different dimension to the relationship of marriage. You know, here we learn that marriage is not merely for companionship or the raising of children. A committed relationship is a gift that has the power to transform and contribute to the emotional and spiritual growth of an individual. Jesus, when he spoke of marriage, concurred with the writer of the creation story that two individuals leave the homes of their parents and they live together in marriage. If one does this with integrity, one leaves the comfort zone of family. And one experiences the intensity of a domestic relationship. And it is that intensity that requires active loving that has the power to transform a human being. Third, I want to be careful because we live with the power of many myths. And one of the pervasive ones in this day and age is that in relationships, we can change another person. Let's put that one to rest right now. Jacob changed, but it was neither Leah nor Rachel that changed him. It was his own willingness to work that was the transforming agent. Jacob actively participated in his own transformation and his own maturation. And this is the miracle of love, when it calls someone to make an effort to grow up. The story of Jacob and Rachel is one of the few love stories in the Bible. It's a beautiful account of romance, and we can learn a great deal from it. And if we read further, as we go into the story, we will discover that Jacob's relationship with these two individuals, Rachel and Leah, was not what we would call marital bliss. They had a rocky road to go. It was complex, and it became trying at times, but he was prepared for it. By 7 years plus 7 years of working for another person. 7 years of caring without immediate gratification. After 14 years of living with Laban, Jacob would grow and change. Oh, he'd still be Jacob. He'd still possess that wit, that brain, that opportunism that was part of his youth. But he would become softer, wiser, and more mature. The chronicles of his life do not end here. He had some unfinished business waiting at home. Esau is still hanging around and is still mad. In fact, he's nursing a grudge for 14 years that makes him even mad. And next week, Jacob goes home to see Esau. But the good news here in this story is that God is active in the life of Jacob and also in ours. The love that changed Jacob is a love that still exists in our world. And it has the same power to enable individuals to grow spiritually if they are willing to work. That's the good news.